that was extended to me just a couple of days back. As a matter of fact, when Chairman mentioned it, I considered it not as an invitation, but as an order. An order. And you know, for a party man, like all of us, when our chairman commands, ours is to obey. And that's why a few days even to Christmas, even at this time, I'm here. And I'm delighted that all of you sharing the same spirit of commitment and dedication, even in this Yuletide, found time, all of you, to be here. And that clearly shows how committed and prepared our chairman and the new team are. Because he said he was going to hit the ground running. And this is how you hit the ground running. So, Mr. Chairman and members of the working committee, I congratulate you all. Now, I have been invited to give a talk, not a lecture, but then a talk to fellow party men on issues bordering on conflict resolution. And this is a very apposite subject matter, particularly for us in this party at this time. Just even before coming here, I was on the phone with one of our party leaders, who I understand from the newspaper reports is taking our family dispute somewhere else. And I spoke with him and we have agreed that the committee, my reconciliation committee, as soon as practicable, will get in touch with Professor Adedoja, whom I assured that our party holds in very high esteem. Because in this party, every member is important. Every leader is important. And that underscores the imperative of consensus building, the imperative of conflict resolution. Because what is a political party in the first place? And that's why our chairman, who knows what it means to build a party, who has been involved in running and administering our party. And he has been involved in this right from the days of MPN. A quintessential party builder and party man. He understands that building a political party, especially in opposition as we are now, means all of us must continually remind ourselves about the imperatives of consensus building and of conflict resolution. I think that's why I've been invited. Now, politics itself is the art of resolving conflicts in society. Because society is in a perpetual state of conflicts between tendencies and interest groups, some more defined, more pronounced than others. So society constantly is a contest between interest groups. Some for good reasons, some reasons more nobler than others. But that is what politics is all about in any given society. Therefore, political party administrators must understand that having conflicting interests, even within a party, is a normal phenomenon. Just look at the more established and the older political parties in the advanced democracies. Take, for example, when John McCain in the US lost the presidential election to Barack Obama. His running mate, Sarah Palin, and the core conservatives went to their roots and came up with what they call the Tea Party movement. Now, if that is too far, just look at the campaigns within the Republican Party that brought up Donald Trump. In every political party, even within the party, you have conflicting tendencies. And all of them important. All of them legitimate. Because just as society is made up of several conflicting interests, also, within a political party itself, it is normal to have tendencies. And so it's important that party administrators understand these essential dynamics and know that our duty, all of us, our duty, more in opposition now than when you are in government. But mind you, even when you are in government, every day, party chairman and president are solving conflicting interests. If it is not about determining candidates, it's about determining who will get appointment. When, where, and when. So these are constants in the political dynamics. So all of us, and especially you, all of you who have now the responsibility of holding and managing the party bureaucracy, need to understand these essential dynamics. So when you see differences of opinion, even differences of ambition, conflicting ambitions, and so on, know that it is nothing out of the blue. It's normal. And your duty is to see how, working with other colleagues, you resolve it through the laid down processes of the party. The only thing we insist on, which is why we are now reaching out to everybody since after the convention, and we'll do so, and working with the chairman who understands what it means to run a party, working with the zonal leaders who will give briefings, working with the state chairman, we will reach out to even those at the state chapters with the leaders guiding us to talk about even interests that are in conflict. But all of this must be managed in the overall interest of the party. So whether you agree, whether there is tension, whether there is conflict or not, these are legitimate. But the only qualification is that they must operate in the overall interest of the political party itself. They cannot be, these interests are not legitimate once they go outside the party interests. But within the party interests, people can come with different ambitions and tendencies and groups. It's normal. But they must all be subordinate to the party structures. They must all be subordinate to the party hierarchy and must not operate outside the party's identified objectives. So I charge you all, as we prepare to reorganize, because this is the very first time that our party is in opposition. Even in this hall, there are not many who have had a taste of opposition politics. It's not many. But for the past 2 years, all of us have been in opposition. The mindset when you are running a party in opposition should be different. It's different. When people are in opposition, they come together. That's when they even conspire better. Because politics is conspiracy. Conspiracy upon conspiracy, but in the national interest. Conspiracies and conspiracies within the party, legitimate, all equal, but in the interest of the party, not against it. Now, you saw how the other side, and you know what I mean, how they sank their differences, seemingly irreconcilable, but they had an objective. Those tendencies and divisions only became clearer by the time they had power. Because we believe that they were not prepared for the power they eventually had. Is that not so?
Yes, sir.
So now that we're in opposition, our success to a large extent depends on you, all of you, your understanding of the dynamics of managing conflicts within our party. Such that when we are taking a decision, and this is why this chairman, for those of us who know him, is coming to this job with a tremendous advantage of understanding of how a party operates. This chairman understands that a party, political party, exists to win elections. Parties are in the business of winning elections and winning power. Is that not so?
Yes.
So if you are a political party, you have lost election, and you are behaving that everything is normal, then there must be something wrong. When a party loses an election, that's when you wake up from your slumber and you say, gentlemen, what has happened? What has hit us? What did we do wrong? What can we do differently? And this is when all of us should be asking ourselves that question. But as I said earlier, this chairman and his team and all of you understand that a party that does not win an election is a dead party. Even if you look at the INEC list of political parties, there are now about 60-something or 70-something. Yes, political parties. So the difference between one party and another is their understanding of how to win power. Because that's the sole purpose of a political party. Winning power to deliver service. We did that for 16 years, we're in power, but now we're in opposition. But this chairman understands that a candidate he will put forward must be the best candidate for that election who has the highest chances of winning an election. And it is my recommendation that this should trickle down. If you are in a position to determine who should be your councillorship candidate, please, for God's sake, forget about whether the man is not greeting you enough. Forget about whether you like his face or not. Your focus should be, can this candidate win? The same for all offices. And I give you an instance. I started this dispensation from my NADECO affiliations down to my activism in the Niger Delta issues to the 80. And by the time that came up, and I know National Vice Chairman Southwest was also in that canoe. By the time we took that decision, the leaders that were following had formed PDP. They pulled us out, went to APP, formed it. They pulled us out, and then finally formed it. When I took the party to Bayelsa, all leaders had gone to either PDP or APC. Sorry? APP. They had gone to APP or PDP. But then you can imagine, almost 18 years out of my life, I was a young legal practitioner and activist.
Yes.
But we now, no secretariat. My vehicle was the secretariat. We were wooing candidates the way there are a lot of women here and we are a gender sensitive party. Let me end it on that. But what I'm saying is, we were wooing candidates. The gentleman who ended up winning the House of Reps, which we won in my constituency. 1998, we won House of Reps. Sabama Kiremo Federal. It. I later represented that constituency twice. And Kasina, chairman, yes, my colleague in the House. The senator in that constituency, it, how? Because we were waiting for the big parties to fight. I will send spies there. and say, who is their most popular candidate who didn't win? The spies after the convention will come back. Say, chairman, is that man that they skimmed out? Say, that is our candidate. And we will track them. Even throwing the form at them, they didn't pay. I remember one of them said, his wife, Oyibo woman, and chairman knows all of them, because this chairman has been involved for a long time, he knows all the people. One of them with an Oyibo wife said, you are worrying my husband too much. You want to put us in politics for trouble. So leave my house. But the husband ended up winning Senate seats on that platform of it. And she became wife of a senator. So that was how we did, even for the assembly seats we won. So gentlemen, the success or otherwise of a political party, when we are in opposition, as we are like this, depends on the judgments you people make and the tolerance and maturity you display. You people are the grassroots, who are commanders in charge of the party machinery. You have to make those sacrifices and make those good determinations. Even when stakeholders may think to the contrary, if you are convinced that a particular candidate is the one that can win to us, for us, you are lucky, because the party leadership at your zonal level and the chairman and his team understand about winning elections. So I think you should feel free to approach them to say, look, my stakeholder says this one is his houseboy. We should field him or field her. But chairman, zonal chairman and national chairman, national secretary, all of the organizing secretary, look, my judgment as a party chairman, our judgment in the state working committee of the party is that this is house boy and house girl and good friend and good boy cannot win for us. We think that Mr. A, who has nobody, is the one that can win. Now, I say you are lucky because you have a firm chairman who understands this. I don't want to bore you about what he has done for a number of us. Take, for example, in my own case, I don't want to talk about what happened in some other states. When the chairman saw that as incumbent governor, it would be disastrous to permit some people who had affiliations with some other power brokers in my state to whittle down our party's influence and create divisions, this chairman, without me telling him, then he was acting national chairman, took decisive steps and said, no, our governor, on the basis of intelligence we have, our governor has performed, our governor has enough acceptability to win, so the party machinery should be behind him and ensure that I won my ticket unopposed. Now let me tell you the importance of that, the significance of that decision that the party took was that it prevented our party from dissipating energy and even resources. So for my re-election, contrary to the blackmail and propaganda people may spawn about chairman and about some of our leaders, we didn't spend any money on party leaders on account of second-term tickets. I think the PDP deserves a round of applause for this. But the point I'm making is that if there ever has been any time when the party needs to do this more in all constituencies, if there has been any time that the party needs to solve problems and exercise right judgment, that time is now. That time is now. So, my dear leaders, Just want to remind you all that the success or otherwise of our party depends on the judgments you exercise, the courage you display, and the choices that you guide the party to make. Our recommendation is that our party, which is the only truly democratic national platform that this country has, should be thrown open to the Nigerian people. And Mr. Chairman, you've started well. You understand this party more than most. And you have our support. You have everyone's support as you move leading party leaders to return our party back to the people of Nigeria. Let the candidates emanate from the people. Let the people own the candidates. Let the people take ownership of the candidates, especially as you are in opposition. You saw the type of election we ran in Bayelsa. Because the people took ownership of my candidature, with all the arsenals displayed, we triumphed, our party triumphed. Because, my dear friends, there is no armory anywhere that is stronger than the armory founded on the people's support. And the founding fathers of our party, if you read the history of our party, they were the masters of this game. All of them who came together, the masters of this game. They founded this party, built and anchored on the sovereignty, on the power of the people. So let the people have their party, and then we move forward in hope. In conclusion, I want to say that all of us should understand, as we go back, identify conflicts which are inevitable in every political party, try as much as possible to resolve them, and where the resolution is proving a little bit tricky, don't hesitate to notify the next ladder of authority. Zonal leaders are very competent and experienced people, all of them. They will give support. Where it is tricky and it needs the intervention, the chairman and the working committee will be notified. And where it is tough, that our committee and other leaders can come in to play a role, we will gladly make ourselves available to play that role. But the duty of resolving conflicts is the responsibility of every party leader. You don't have to be in what we need to do moving forward. So, Mr. Chairman, once again, I thank you. I congratulate you once again. I congratulate all the newly elected members of the working committee of our party. Congratulate the members of the NEC. Congratulate all of you, the state chairman, who are leading our party in very difficult circumstances. But don't worry. We know that the other side is doing a lot of work for us. And you understand what I mean. Yes. Just keep going. They are making our job easier and easier by the kind of government they are running. So, as we stay together and build a united party, resolve conflicts and stay together, working together and praying hard, it is our expectation that the next set of elections will be ours to win by the grace of God. I thank you all, and may God bless and guide all of you. And finally, I bring you season's greetings and warm felicitations from all the country people in Bayelsa. I thank you all, And God bless PDP, God bless Nigeria, God bless you.
Thank you, His Excellency, Governor HSDickson, leading the reconciliation.